Hello and welcome to episode 6 of the gameplaycasts Warhammer 40k miniatures challenge. In this episode, I unveil my completed final miniatures. Have I managed to pull it off? Well, let's get into it and find out. Just before we get into the final reveals, I wanted to do a quick recap. The challenge was, could I paint these three miniatures I had on hand to a high enough standard that I'd be able to sell them so that my startup costs were covered or at least significantly offset? Well, let's see how I did. The table on the left is my original outlay, while the table on the right is my final outlay. I'll be the first to admit that my tools and material costs might have spiraled out of control just a little bit. It became an addiction, and it's an addiction that I'm feeding. So far, I've knocked up a paint holder out of some scrap wood. I've already bought my Horus Lupercal model. I've subscribed to Warhammer Plus, and I may or may not have bought the Lion and Retinue when it came out recently. Anyway, it's clear that my costs were quite a lot higher than I anticipated, but once I got going, I really wanted to get a good finish quality on these models, so it's in for a penny, in for a pound in my mind at this point. Anyway, let's get to those grand reveals. Okay, no messing about. Here's my finished Primaris miniature. I ended up doing two null-null runs to pick out all the joints and details, as the Mechanicus undercoat really didn't add the depth of shadow I wanted. I also tidied up the model a lot, re-adding the mid-tones with some Macragge Blue, and then some highlights and wet blending with Khalgar Blue, some edge highlighting with Fenrisian Grey, and some White Scar White for the really peak highlights. You can see the edge highlighting isn't tidiest, but for a first attempt, I'm pretty happy with it. Something I have noticed is that the model looks a lot better in real life versus the camera on my phone. Not sure if the settings I'm using are wrong, but the video seems to pick out a lot of elements and colours that are just not visible to the naked eye. Strange. I'll definitely need to get myself a proper camera for future projects. Also, I couldn't resist spending more money on a drill to bore out the muzzle of the bolt rifle. It's actually crazy how much difference this little detail makes. And last thing I added was some transfers, followed by a layer of matte varnish. I had to freehand the assault arrow on his right pauldron, as I didn't have the right transfer pack also. In total, I think this mini took around 6 to 8 hours, which is a long time. I think this is mainly because I started off with some frankly terrible brushes, and it took me ages to correct all the mistakes. I did learn a lot, and my speed going forward was a lot better. But I did manage to feed my addiction with some new brushes.
Heresy grows from idleness.
I kind of went to town with my Demon Prince and added a lot of extra details. Here's how he looked before, and here's how he looks now. I really pushed the glow from the lava through a mixture of dry brushing and glazing in both orange and yellow. The same process was used on the rocks closest to the lava, and I feel the fiery glow really ties the model and base together. Honestly, I'm amazed how much you can achieve with the combination of dry brushing and patience. It really looks awesome. Next up, I wanted to add another dimension to the sword. I wanted to make it look and feel like something otherworldly, like it's alive with light and power. I achieved this again through dry brushing applied to the areas around the blade, the colour being a mix of the same green I used for the sword along with some white. I then used my swanky new 000 Artist Opus brushes to add all the extra details like the eyes, teeth and bolts. I ended up redoing all the horns and protruding bone spikes too, as the skeleton hordes straight onto the primer just didn't do it for me. To get the finished look, I base coated them again in white, reused skeleton horde. However, this time I added a wraithbone dry brush on the tips and several coats of nullnoil on the roots and bases. I then finished off his skin with some highlighting by adding some white areas, which I then glazed with my custom skin mix. This is probably the downside of contrast paints, because you can't really just add white to shade them a bit lighter and then reapply them on. It just doesn't really look right. I kind of tried doing that and I ended up with this really weird sort of matte finish to it, which I just really didn't like. So I had to just paint white onto the areas of the skin and then reglaze it just with thinned down coats of custom skin mix we used in the previous episode. Finally, I was left with just the wings to finish. I used several nullnoil washes around the edges of the wing joints to build up a dark periphery around each wing segment. The colour was still a bit too light, so I ended up darkening it with a couple of washes applied over all of the skin segments. The finishing touch was to add some orange dry brushing to the underside, simulating the glow of lava. I would say reviving this guy took me about 20 or so hours of work, and it actually did come out nice. I'm really happy I went and ordered a bigger base, and all you guys out there who say bases make the model, you are so right. Definitely developing some separation anxiety though at the idea of selling this guy. Oh no. Boom. Here he is, introducing Merrick Whitehill, Gnome Wizard. Out of all the models, this one was by far the quickest. I think in total it was done in a single night, maybe 3 to 4 hours. The blue contrast paint, applied correctly for this model, really did all the hard work on his hair and beard. I even managed to go the extra mile and paint his eyes in with some black and white. And he doesn't look too cross-eyed, which is a big bonus. In terms of his robes, a single Nuln Oil wash added all the depth and detail I could have asked for, leaving me to add the gold detailing to his book and shoe buckles. I also free-handed a simple red pattern to his cape. I did honestly contemplate trying to draw the D&D ampersand logo, but thankfully I thought better of it. The cape is tiny, and I should stick to my limits here. After that, it was all about making the fire look as realistic as possible. Once again, I did this mainly through dry brushing with a few glazes thrown in to help blend the colours together. I just built up from yellow to orange to red, and obeyed the most important rule. When you are happy with it, stop. I was, so I stopped. The final step was to dry brush some light reflections back onto the main body, and voila, one awesome looking D&D miniature. If you'll allow me to say so myself. There was one disaster, however, where I may or may not have snapped his ankles. This is a resin miniature, so it's a tad brittle. To repair this, after supergluing, I used some green stuff wrapped around his ankles to hopefully strengthen them up and make it less of a weak spot. So congratulations if anyone spotted his fat ankles. And that, as they say, is that. Here's all three models in one last big final reveal. Everyone else seems to have a dry ice machine at this point. Maybe I need to invest? All's well that ends well. I'm really pleased with the finish quality I was able to get on the miniatures, and given my massive investment in tools and materials, that should only get better going forward. I hope you've enjoyed the Warhammer 40k Challenge series and the journey of rediscovery it took me on. Please leave a comment if you've enjoyed this series, or if you have any suggestions on how I might improve my content going forward. And of course, please let me know what you think of my miniatures. Equally, as you briefly glimpsed, I have several projects underway, any of which could be used to make future video series. I suppose, as a minimum, I should cover my Horus Lupercal project and give you a final cost analysis if or when I sell any of the miniatures featured in this series. But that will all depend on the success or failure of this current series. So if you want me to create a Lunar Wolves Horus Lupercal video series, please like the series videos and let me know in the comments. I also have the Warhammer Plus model Azrak the Annihilator and the Lion and Retinue models ready to go, so I could create a series on those too. And all that's left for me to say at this point is, I've been Tim from gameplaycasts. Peace out, and thanks for watching.